every word, every act. His assurance and His love. Why fear when I am here, He said. For every devotee, He is here, there, and everywhere. Painfully guiding every step like a dance teacher. As the bud blossomed to reveal 1,000 petals, it can only be said that the fragrance of the first few years is unique.
We often feel that if we pray to Swami to grant us vibhuti, suddenly you will see 2 days later somebody will come and give vibhuti. Maybe vibhuti will come from a photograph. We somehow feel that if we ask for vibhuti, Swami will grant our wish. But if I ask for a house, little time it may take. Because we impress our own limitations onto God. For me, getting coffee or getting vibhuti is easy. But making a house is tough for me. So for God also it might be tough, right? If I pray for vibhuti, He'll grant it. Or if I pray for a house, He may take. He'll grant it, but maybe it'll take 2 years. This is how we impress our own limitations onto the Lord. One of India's leading writers, R.K. Narayanan, writes about how a buffalo was asked to describe God. And the buffalo describes saying, the Lord is a buffalo with the biggest horns, a long tail, powerful legs, and His bellow can be heard across 4 villages. We often think that the Lord is a grander version of ourselves. It is not. It is beyond comprehension what the Lord is. That's why, you know, the Lord is defined by the statement Anoraniyan Mahato Mahiyan. He's smaller than the smallest, yet He's grander than the largest. See, there's a photograph of Swami at Chidambaraya's home. He became like a son at that home. In fact, Swami would get up early in the morning and sweep and keep the home ready. He would finish his bath.
And keep hot water for everybody.
Hot water ready for everybody else. That is how He used to do. After this, you know, Swami traveled to a place called Illuru, which is near Kallur Junction Railway Station, which comes along the Bangalore-Guntakal Railway Line near the Penna River. The clerk or the government accountant who had been stationed at Illuru was a cousin of Karanam Subbamma. His name was Karanam Adinarayan Rao. He was like the village chieftain there. And so Kallur is the railway junction. So Swami goes to Kallur and then goes via horse cart to Illuru. Little ahead is a place called Pamidi. Now Pamidi is a decently big town. Vishwanatha Rao, the son of Chidambaraya, whom we just introduced, he was actually working in Pamidi. He would trek over the hills every day, because that was the fastest way to reach Illuru from Pamidi every evening for bhajans. And Swami would be very happy when He comes for bhajans, because at Illuru there were no bhajan singers. Swami was the only singer, and when Vishwanatha Rao comes, it's some relief, okay, because He used to sing. Swami named Vishwanatha Rao as Patala Abbai. Patala Abbai means the singer boy. And so Swami was very happy whenever Vishwanatha Rao visited. Now after that, one day Swami just decided that it was time to leave. So early in the morning, He left Illuru, went to Kallur, took the train and left for Ananthapur. It so happened that Karanam Adinarayan Rao's household did not know Swami had left. When they got up, they got very panicky. They said, oh my God, something bad is going to happen. They felt scared actually. They thought some calamity will befall us. So they chased Swami all the way back to Ananthapur, telling Swami, you come back. You can't leave like this. You come back. Swami said, okay, you go back. I'll come. And He told Vishwanatha Rao that we have to go back. We are going back to Illuru. And I feel this is a lesson that we should all take. It is a point, it is a time to get scared if the Lord leaves. The Lord, of course, never leaves us. But definitely, we sometimes seem to move away from the Lord. And it is definitely a time to get scared when we move away from the Lord. Now here, from Ananthapur, while going back with Vishwanatha Rao, Swami stopped at the home of M. Narayan Rao because he had promised him earlier that he would have lunch there. And after he had lunch there, Swami says that there is a photographer in this region. And that photographer's name is K.H. Rayudu. Swami says, I want a photo session now. I want my photo to be taken. Please call him home and let him take my photograph. K.H. Rayudu has earned a good name as a photographer. He is famous. His studio is famous. And he doesn't believe in all these saints and sadhus and all this. And he thinks, now this boy says he's some incarnation of Shirdi Baba. So with all his doubts and his arrogance, he comes. He has to photograph Swami. And seeing the preparations, you know, he's put off even more. Because instead of a nice lighting and all this, what this family is doing is, they are keeping all agarbattis and coconuts and offerings and aarti and like some altar they're creating, and he is, oh my God, get it done with fast. And once that is done, he looks through his camera to focus, and he's shocked. Because through the camera, he's seeing only Shirdi Baba. Portraits of Shirdi Baba. If a coconut is there, instead of coconut, one small Shirdi Baba portrait. If there's an agarbatti, instead of a long agarbatti, one long Shirdi Baba portrait. Everything inside is Shirdi Baba portrait. The other people say, take the photograph fast. Now he doesn't want to look like as if he's hallucinating. He says, there's some focusing problem, and half an hour goes by and he's not able to photograph. And then in his heart, he realizes that, see, this is my arrogance. It is my arrogance that is doing this. And he just, you know, tries to bring in little humility in the heart. Swami says, Vidya Dadati Vinayam. Your talent and skill, if it doesn't give you humility, it's of no use. When he brings in a little humility in his heart, to his great relief, he's able to see things as they are. And he takes a photograph. This is that resulting photograph. You know, now we realize why Swami left Illuru and came. It is not to get away from Adinarayan Rao, but possibly to confer this experience on this photographer. After this, K.H. Rayudu, the photographer, became a devotee of Swami. Now when Swami is starting off, Vishwanatha Rao reminds Swami that, Swami, you had promised my mother you will have lunch at home. You should at least come home before we go. So Swami agrees and comes. The mother says that, what, you already had lunch? He had lunch at Narayan Rao's home. So Swami, now you have already had lunch. How will you have lunch? Swami says, no, I'll have a second lunch, you don't worry. Has a second lunch, he eats, he gives joy. See, that is the difference. We eat to make ourselves happy. The Lord eats to make others happy. Because bliss is my food. Our joy is his food. And now after going to Illuru, Swami then says that we will go to Pamidi. And there's already a long line of people waiting for interviews. Swami begins his job immediately. And in the interviews, no, this is the rich community, the business people, everybody. Everybody is coming and asking, Swami, this should happen, that should happen. Swami should get child. Swami, sickness should go. Swami, we should get more wealth. Look at this. Who is rich? Who is poor? The people who are supposed to be rich are the ones who are asking the most from Swami. In the meanwhile, there is one wise person, Vishwanatha Rao's uncle, Rachakonda Venkatramaya. Venkatramaya comes there, and as Swami is giving interview inside, he is giving a discourse outside. He calls everyone and says, you fools, you are asking Swami for all these things. You have no idea what it is. It is like going and asking for coffee powder from the Kalpa Vriksha. You should ask only for spiritual gain, only spiritual benefit. And even as he is giving his discourse, somebody comes and tells him, Venkatramaya, Swami is calling you. And he goes, Swami says, what is it that you are telling all of them? He says, Swami, I told them that we should seek only spiritual from Swami. Swami says, very nice, very good. This is what I will do also. He cancels the interviews and Swami grants discourses for 2 days in a row there. In the evening, he takes them to the banks of the river that is there, Penna. And there, of course, he does miracles there in the sands of the Penna River, confers joy to everybody in Pamidi. Apart from the joy, he also confers the wisdom that the only wealth worth acquiring is spiritual wealth. After that, Swami returns to Anantapur.
You know, when he was talking about Pamidi, he said it's a rich man's town. There were a lot of businessmen there. And you kind of expect Swami, who is in need of a lot of good people to support his activities, to go there, right? This is a mistake which you often do. Interestingly, if you read one of the most popular books on Swami, Howard Muffett, he says during his first trip to Puttaparthi, to
when he comes here, he goes around and speaks to all the rich people he can find in Puttaparthi. He is not able to find one person who has given 1 rupee to Swami. He's saying there's so many rich people, but nobody has given money to Swami. Swami has not taken money from any of them. So it is our assumption to think that here is a spiritual man doing spiritual activities. No, Swami is doing a lot of charity, and here are rich people, so obviously they must be giving money to Swami. Mr. Hira from Japan, he was telling about when Swami was doing one of his projects. That time Swami was spending enormous amount of money. Swami had finished all the money in the Central Trust. Swami started mortgaging property. Mr. Hira came and he said, I need to do my bit. So he and a few other people, they decided that they would go around and speak to some of the influential devotees and try to inspire some charity in them. You see, Swami is doing this project. Why don't you all contribute? So he went to the city of London and they had a huge meeting there in the Wimbledon Center, I think. So as he would beautifully describe it, he got a standing ovation, but he did not get anything in pounds. So he came back empty-handed. He was very hurt. He said, not because people did not give. He felt that I am not able to give anything to Swami. So he went back to Japan and he was feeling very bad. He was crying to his wife. He said, I've let down Swami. I'm not able to give anything to Swami. Then suddenly a thought struck him. He said, why am I asking others? Why can't I sell this house of mine and give that money to Swami? So immediately, that moment, he picks up the phone, calls a real estate agent, and he asks, if I want to sell this property, how much would it be? It's in a prime spot in Tokyo, and you know how much did they offer him? They offered him $20 million. And we always like to give this comparison, more expensive than Neverland Ranch that Michael Jackson owned. That's how much money it was. So immediately he said, all right, go about, find the buyer. And he takes the next flight, comes to Puttaparthi, sits in the veranda with his proposal to sell his house and give that money to Swami for the water project. Swami calls him for the interview and he puts this proposal in front of Swami. He said, Swami, this is the house and I can sell it, I can get this much. And what did Swami say? Immediately, he said, no. How did you ever think that I will permit you to do this? And Swami said, which mother would like her son to live in a rented apartment? And he says very beautifully, just that very next day, during that same trip, Swami bursts out of the interview room with a letter in his hand. He says, one of my students has given me this 150 rupees for going, without giving his clothes to the dhobi, washing it himself. He said, the same Swami who refused $20 million is celebrating 150 rupees. What does he want from us? Is he one who is after the money which we can give him? We'll go back to where we left. Swami is in Pamidi. Swami is going back to Anantapur. And it's unimaginable. We are talking about $20 million. The next minute we are at Pamidi and Swami takes a train to Anantapur. Hops into a train, goes to Anantapur, goes to Chidambaraya's house. And Swami is, that's one of the places where Swami is at home. So he's sitting in the garden. He's on his easy chair. He's talking to the children, playing with them. And some of the nice incidents they narrate is one morning Swami says, he calls all the children and he says, go pluck some flowers and come. Let's make garlands for the worship. So they go around the garland and they find that none of the trees seem to be having any flowers. So they go around looking everywhere and they come back to Swami. They said, Swami, there's no flower, not a single flower. Then Swami comes and Swami climbs a tree, okay, and pulls one branch down. And lo and behold, when Swami pulls it down, it's full of flowers. So they very happily pluck those flowers and they make a garland for Swami.
Isn't that the story of our lives too? He touches us and we have blossomed. That's what happened to the tree also. The minute he touched, it had blossoms.
Definitely, this is exactly what he has done to all of us. The hostel building in Vrindavan is named after Walter Cowan, right? He's a devotee from the United States. And he was one of those devotees who was resurrected by Swami. How aptly the building is named the Walter Cowan Block. Because all of us have got life in that building in Vrindavan. At this point, probably it's a very good point to mention another stalwart devotee. His name is Thirumal Rao. He's that person. He was a landlord. He owned prime property in Bangalore. By hobby, he was an horticulturist. He loved to have beautiful gardens, and he was one of the best in that. We all know that Bangalore is called the Garden City, right? In India, we call Bangalore the Garden City. It's filled with gardens. In such a city, his garden was so famous that Queen Elizabeth came to see his garden. That's how famous he was. So this devotee was another devotee in whose house Swami spent a lot of time. So he was one of the people who visited Swami when he was in Anantapur at Chidambaraya's house. And along with him, Swami goes to Bangalore and stays at the house of Tirumal Rao. And that's his wife, Pushpakanti. And their son was born with one leg shorter than the other. It was definitely one of their troubles, one of the events in their life which troubled them. But they did not pray to Swami to cure. But Swami did ensure that he got some sort of a cure because he could walk on his own after that. Not that he was completely cured.
Now, in the meanwhile, another stalwart devotee who again had great role to play in the mission, not only through him, through his family. This was Seshagiri Rao. You know, Seshagiri Rao's wife and wife's sister, they had visited Swami. And again, yet another case where the woman draws the man to the Lord. So they came and told Seshagiri Rao that, you know, this is amazing. We must go to Puttaparthi. It is fantastic. Now, Seshagiri Rao was a devotee of Lord Shiva. I've already pledged my heart to Shiva. How can I change? So he said, no way, I'm not going to come to Puttaparthi. That time, you know, these two ladies said that at Penukonda, there were many people who did not like Swami. So anybody who was headed towards Swami, they would throw stones. They would impede their journey, prevent them from going to Swami. They said, see, it is dangerous for two ladies to go alone there. So at least come as an escort. And they also gave him a suggestion. They said, see, they had a relative who was staying somewhere very close to Puttaparthi, possibly in Puttaparthi itself. They said, see, that relative is there. You can go and stay at his house. You need not come for the darshan and all that, but you should definitely escort us. And Seshagiri Rao agreed. He said, okay, fine. That is something I feel is acceptable. We'll go there. You finish whatever you want. I'm not going to come there. I will stay at this person's home. And as soon as possible, we'll leave and return back to Bangalore. He said, can we stay for a day or two at least? He said, no way. As soon as one darshan you do, one bhajan, whatever, we return after that. So they said, okay. And they have started early in the morning. It's about 5 or 5:30 in the evening when they reach. And they go to the mandir for darshan. At this point in time, now Seshagiri Rao is overcome with curiosity. No harm in just looking at who this guy is, what is it that he's doing, and this is something interesting, just curiosity. And bhajans are going on, and you know, these two ladies, they reach there, they have to go, it's a separate ladies side, separate gents side. And as they are going to sit for the bhajans, they hear a thud. They turn around, Seshagiri Rao has collapsed. And Swami comes immediately, creates vibhuti, and he says, you don't worry. So they feel little kind of comfort and satisfaction. Okay, Swami has taken up his case, so I think it should be fine. Swami says, he will be like this for 2 more days. Oh my God. But you don't worry. Swami in fact asks for Seshagiri Rao to be taken to a room next to his own room. And he is placed there. And Swami says, you don't worry about this, continue with the bhajan. And every 2-3 hours, Swami comes, puts vibhuti, gives water, everything. And the Seshagiri Rao is gone like this. They ask, Swami, what happened? And Swami says, he will come and he will tell you what happened. So they don't even have a diagnosis, no doctor. Absolutely by faith, they are staying there. Swami has said, after 2 days, he'll come back. Okay, let us see. So after 2 days, Seshagiri Rao actually wakes up. And then they rush to him. They ask him, what happened? How are you? He is just having tears of joy. He says, all my life, you know, I have worshipped Shiva. And when I saw there, I saw my Lord with the moon, with the Ganga, with the snake, the Jata Juta, with the Damru, the Trishul. I had the darshan of Lord Shiva. I was unable to bear it. He doesn't know that he has been gone for 2 days. He thinks that he has had his darshan and he has woken up now. They say, no, you were gone for 2 days. So, oh my God. They say, okay, now, anyway, you wanted to go back to Bangalore in 1 day, right? Come, let's go now. 2 days we have been here. He says, are you mad? All my life I have been seeking Shiva. And today, having got him, you want me to leave and come to Bangalore? What about our security? Arre, this is Shiva. He can take care of me, he can take care of you. You go to Bangalore, I'm not coming. Ever since that day, Seshagiri Rao did not leave Puttaparthi at all. He settled in Puttaparthi. He resigned from his job, whatever he was doing. He in fact became the first priest for Swami. Till then, Swami used to himself take the aarti. He said, Swami, you are Lord Shiva. Shiva should not do aarti. We should do aarti to Shiva. I will do aarti. He became the first priest. And the beautiful point here is, you see, Swami never said, give up Shiva and come to me. Give up Ganesha, come to me. We have seen so many examples. There have been cases where Swami gave darshan as Ganesha. You are loyal to Ganesha, stick to Ganesha. Whatever form you are loyal to, be loyal to that form. Continue to be loyal to that form. If we feel that our chosen form and name is that of Swami, I feel we should stick on to that. Hold on to that. Arre, this is a divine romance. I can't change. I can't keep changing my lover every now and then. I can't say, okay, Shirdi Baba, okay, Parthi Baba, now Prem. No. Premasai, if you come, you better give me darshan as Satya Sai, because all my heart is already pledged to Satya Sai and I have only one heart.